Well, if you would indulge me, I would like to read the scripture one more time. I just think it's so important to hear the word of God and receive it. And it's helpful to read it multiple times, but at least twice this morning. So prepare your hearts for one more reading from Romans 12, verses 3 through 8. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as one body we have many members, and the members do not all have the same function, so we, though many, are one body in Christ, and individually members one of another, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us. Let us use them. If prophecy in proportion to our faith, if service in our serving, the one who teaches in his teaching, the one who exhorts in his exhortation, the one who contributes in generosity, the one who leads with zeal, and the one who does acts of mercy with cheerfulness. Well, I have shared this before, so some of you may know that this chapter in Romans, chapter 12, has been a significant one in my life ever since I was a kid. And this isn't because I was a particularly spiritual or devoted child or teen for that matter, but one thing I did do was keep a copy of the Children's Living Bible in a drawer next to my bedstand. In fact, this copy, which I found several years ago, tucked away in my parents' attic. Many nights I would take this out and read it. The thing is, I didn't have any aspirations at all of reading the whole thing through. I really only opened it and read a couple of passages. Sometimes I would read the Sermon on the Mount in Matthew 5 to 7, but mostly I would read Romans 12. In fact, when I found it, the bookmark was right where I left it. And as a young boy of 8 or 9, I had written in the front that's marked my important events. This scripture, it says Romans 12. It turns out I didn't know how important and prophetic this word was to myself when I wrote that. But more than any other scripture, Romans 12 has shaped and formed my Christian life and calling over the years. And this isn't because it's given me all the answers and the questions I have about life and about God, but because it's given me a proper perspective and wisdom of living a Christian life. It's given me a vision for ministry, living a holy and responsible life to God. It's challenged me to live well and to live within my limits, to leave to God what only God can do, to leave for others what only others could do or can do better than myself. In short, this scripture, Romans 12, has kept me throughout my life. And the whole of Romans chapter 12 sits very strongly in the middle of my relationship with Jesus. And thankfully, I'm not preaching on the whole chapter 12, or we could be here for a while. We're just looking at verses 3 through 8 this morning. And I thought it may be helpful for you to hear what I was hearing as I read this as an 8, 9, 10-year-old. To hear what, in verses 3 through 8 especially, I would hear from this living book that I kept in a drawer at my bedside. I would hear these words. Be honest in your estimate of yourself. We are all parts of Christ's body, and it takes every one of us to make it complete. Or we belong to each other, and each needs all the others. God has given us, or He has given each of us, the ability to do certain things well. If you are a teacher, do a good job of teaching. And not that I ever dreamed of being a preacher, but then there was this line. If you are a preacher, see to it that your sermons are strong and helpful. So that's my prayer for this sermon this morning, that is strong and helpful. But it's also my desire that I not complicate the fairly simple message and points of these verses in God's Word for us this morning. And so I want to point these out to you. Three of them. They are this. Remember that we need each other. Recognize your God-given gift and do your part to build up the body of Christ. Remember that we have and we need each other. Recognize your God-given gift and do your part to build up the body of Christ. Let us pray together as we get started. God of grace, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we rejoice in the opportunity to hear from you, to hear from your word again this morning. We open up our lives to you and invite you to do your work among us, not only as a body, but as individuals, parts of that body. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing unto you, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Well, we have begun a series called Church Fatigue, Overcoming Our Overwhelmings, which has a wonderful visual aid to it. If you've seen the poster that's promoted this series, it's the dreaded battery is dangerously running low icon. In fact, I saw that battery running low last night as I was writing up this sermon. The red line at the bottom of that battery reminds us that we need to find an energy source and fast. It's the kind of situation we often find ourselves in the church and in our spiritual lives, whether we know it or not. And this is especially true in the hectic and hurried lifestyle of our Boston culture, and I suspect it's true to an extent everywhere. We certainly feel this overwhelming fatigue more acutely in our workplace, with the crazy long hours that are that we keep, the lofty expectations of us, or impossible deadlines to meet. Or we feel it at our schools with the all-nighters we have to pull, or the exams we're studying for, all that to be followed by the stress of finding a job. Or in our family life, the just tiredness of the ins and outs of everyday living. But fatigue is found in the church too. Perhaps not all of us, but enough of us that we need to address are running near empty on compassion or faith. We have a very low capacity for forgiveness or for mercy, or we're running dangerously low on spiritual zeal or grace-filled service. Now, it's hard to diagnose, self-diagnose, overwhelming or fatigue, but if you found yourself murmuring any of the following phrases, you might be susceptible. Things like, I can't do another thing. I can't fit anything else into my schedule. Or, I can't deal with that person anymore. I'm done with them. Or, I just can't give. I can't give anything, and certainly not cheerfully. Or, I'm not appreciated here. In fact, no one will even miss me when I'm gone. If any of those thoughts have crossed your mind, you likely are overwhelmed. You don't have space in your life to receive or even hear the pleas of help or volunteering or serving at Park Street or your kid's school or at your school or your community or your neighborhood. But we fashion this sermon series because we don't want you to be overwhelmed and fatigued with life, and church life especially. We don't even want you to come to terms or negotiate with fatigue or being overwhelmed. Perhaps you've done this. I can survive this pace for a season. I'll just keep it up for a couple of years. I can rest later. No, I want to tell you, if you must be overwhelmed, we want you to be overwhelmed with God. Be overwhelmed by Jesus, who said, "In me you may have peace. In this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world." Next week I'll be preaching on faith fatigue and the difficulty we often experience of waiting on God. But this week it's on serving fatigue. And serving fatigue within the church can come from several different factors. I'm going to just briefly mention three possibilities that can cause serving fatigue. The first is being overwhelmed by the never-ending and difficult needs of the church community, or all the many opportunities there are to serve. Park Street Church is a large church, and there's something that always needs to be done, which is why we need to remember that we have and need each other. We're in this together. Another factor for serving fatigue is being fatigued by serving too long in an area where you're not really gifted. Perhaps you're an introvert in an extroverted role. I found myself there often. Perhaps someone has roped you in into greeting people at the door or helping newcomers get connected into the church, and you're exhausted within 15 minutes and dreading the next time that you come up on the list. Well, it's easy to get fatigued if we're meeting a need or filling a role in contradiction to who we are, who God has designed us and gifted us to be. So this is why we need to recognize our God-given gift. Or perhaps serving fatigue is the result of being burned out because too few people seem to be doing all of the work, which is why we don't stop with just discerning how we are gifted, but we actually do our part, however small or however big it is, to support and grow and keep healthy the body of Christ. Now you may be sitting there saying, I'm not feeling overwhelmed or suffering from serving fatigue. And so I want to assure you that the truths here in Romans 12 and these verses are applicable in season and out of season, in easy and blessed times and in hard and stressed times. And so again, I don't want to complicate the message, and forgive me if I do. The simple truths found here can help us recover and refresh from wherever we are. Remember that we need each other. Recognize your God-given gifts, and do your part to build up the body of Christ. So to our passage, in verse 3, Paul begins with these words, "For by the grace given to me." Now I don't want to overlook this key word, grace. Grace given to me is not just a grace given for salvation. It's also a grace given for participation in our life with God, especially with the way Paul is using the words here. Paul is speaking out of this grace given to him, and he's finishing this sentence, this idea, by saying, I say to everyone among you, by this grace given, I say. Paul is exercising his gift of grace, his gift of apostleship. He's doing his part in the body of Christ by writing these words. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think with sober judgment. And God gives us grace for the same reasons, the grace of salvation and the grace of participation with God in the work he is doing in and through the church. The grace of God leads to a full, refreshed, and restored life. And so I want to start with pointing out that as we look at that icon that's on the poster promoting this series of fatigue, by simply saying it's grace that fills that dangerously low battery up. It's not serving and work in the church that fills it up. It's grace. And if you are without grace, it is completely understandable that you are overwhelmed or fatigued or burned out. So I want you to hear this clearly, because the last thing I want to communicate through this message is that you need to be doing more because there's so much work to be done. That's not what Paul's saying. And that's not what I'm saying. No, you need God's grace. Because it's only out of this place of grace that we are able to give of ourselves to God and to serve each other from a full and restored and energized life. God's grace is God's gift to you. And you get it like any other gift by receiving it. And you experience it by responding to it. And one way to respond to God's grace is just what Paul is going on to say in the rest of chapter 12, and especially in these next few verses. And he starts with this: do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think. God's grace will do that, will help you with that. In verse 3, Paul does a clever thing. He repeats the same root word in Greek meaning to think, and he repeats it four times in one phrase. Now, he could have easily just said, which he has said elsewhere, be humble. or imitate Christ Jesus, or think of others before yourselves. But instead, he writes, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but think with sober judgment. The word judgment there has that root word think, sober thinkment, sober judgment. His play on this word to think reminds us not only of the importance of thinking through or obeying what he is saying here, but how much our minds and our thinking is involved in our spiritual life. He has just written in verse 2, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's something that we're familiar with, and I remember even as a kid wondering, what does that mean to be transformed by the renewing of your mind? It's just something that I soaked in for many years before I realized that Paul goes on to explain what he means by the renewing of the mind. Because in the verses that we hear today, Paul, Paul describes what a renewed mind looks like. It's one that thinks of itself with sober judgment. A renewed mind is one that has a proper measure, an estimation of oneself. A renewed mind recognizes itself as a member, a part of a body, and it's one that knows its role and fulfills it. It might be humbling to admit it, but it is true. And with renewed minds, we need to get our heads around it. We are limited. We're only a part of the whole. We can't and we shouldn't do it all. Somewhere along the lines, we get just the opposite message of that. But Paul is saying we're limited. We're only part of the whole. We can't and shouldn't do it all. We not only belong to each other, we need each other. If it's helpful to you to understand that no one, not even Jesus, can do the work of the gospel on one's own, and Jesus did this, demonstrated this for us by just taking on flesh, limiting himself by becoming human. And we see in his ministry, in Luke especially, that he has strong boundaries and leaves the work of the ministry and encourages the work of ministry to others, his apostles. So there's unfinished work to be done, even for us today. So if Jesus must rely or even depend upon others to complete the work of ministry, then so must we. Now, remembering that we need each other to fulfill God's purposes in this church and in his world may sound rather obvious or boring today. But this would have been a very significant exhortation to the church in Rome at the time of Paul writing this around 55 AD. Because at the time, the church in Rome was a divided community, Jewish believers and Gentile believers trying to make their way together as a Christian community. A Rome church had taken root, perhaps from some Jews in Rome who were present in Jerusalem at Pentecost when the church was founded. Though the church in Rome began first then with these Jewish believers, the church had grown by the time Paul is writing this letter several years later to be primarily made up of Gentiles. And we know this is likely true because Emperor Claudius had issued an edict in 49 AD that required all Jews to leave Rome. There's a record of that in Acts 18, verse 2. And so the Jewish Christians were no longer in Rome, but they began to filter back over the years. And so 4 or 5 years later, when Paul is writing this letter, there's no doubt that tensions and divisions existed within the Rome church. And this is why Paul's letter spends so much ink writing about the Jew and Gentile relationships. And so imagine them being told, you need each other. You belong to each other. You are one body in Christ. This for them would have been a sobering thought. And so Paul says, think with sober judgment. Think clearly about who you are. Think rightly about what you can do and give to the body. It's not only just remembering that we're limited and a part of the whole and that we need each other. It's recognizing that we often come into right thinking or clear thinking from other people. Other people speaking truth into our lives, He's calling them to a radical trust of one another. Now for us today, this of course can come from God's Word as we study it and allow God's Word to speak to us individually. But if you are fortunate to have a friend or a spouse or someone who can tell you the truth about yourself so that you're not deceived by wrong thinking, you are blessed. It's easy to have an inflated sense of self if we kind of do our own self-evaluation and think, what am I good at? What can I do? But someone that can tell you the truth about yourself. Now, I don't mean always being told what is wrong or right morally, but more I mean being told what you're really good at, how you're gifted, what are your limits, and how God uses you in their life. I know, for instance, in my own life, and this comes from probably 20-plus years of feedback from friends and family members, that I am a much better listener than I am a speaker. That I am someone who processes information way better than shares information. And so this fleshes itself out in the church community by me saying to you, you don't want me to make that announcement for you. I can make even the most exciting event sound uninteresting. If you need some ideas for some good reasons and why you should do that event, I'm happy to do that for you. But someone else can announce it. And probably someone else should announce it as they step up and play their part in the body. I am blessed by people that can give announcements well. You know what I mean. You know what I mean. We each have different gifts. So Paul writes in verse 6, having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, let us use them. We do have different gifts. Are you aware of what yours is? And how would you recognize a God-given gift to you? Certainly, two ways to recognize our God-given gifts are to pray and to familiarize ourselves with the scripture passages that speak about spiritual gifts. So this one in Romans 12, also 1 Corinthians 12, Ephesians 4, and 1 Peter 4. Those passages do have lists of gifts, and certainly in the context you can understand why they are pointed out and they're described a little bit and what we should do with them. In addition to those passages and praying, being aware as you look back in your life or even currently about what your passions and your joys are, what activities that you do, or serving the church especially, that refresh you or energize you or bring out your creativity and vitality and gladness. When we think about serving, we often think it's exhausting. But it could be because you're serving in the wrong way. Because if you're serving in ways along your passion and your joy, it's revitalizing. It's energizing. The best way, however, I think, to discern your gift is to be affirmed in your calling. To be affirmed in your serving and your exercising of your gifts by those around you who know you the best, by your community, whether it's a small group community or your family or a group of friends. In fact, my calling to pastoral ministry was not because I woke up one day and realized, yeah, I really want to put on a robe when I go to work. It was the fact that I was continually affirmed of my listening and leading skills in a small group community that I was a part of for several years. It took me a while to actually listen to them about it, but it was a calling that I received through them and their continual affirmation of my listening and leading skills. So we're not only to discern our own gifts as the body of Christ, we are to encourage the gifts given to others. And so I'm so grateful for that group who spoke up to me. And for some reason, we tend not to be so good at doing this. I don't know why that is. We're afraid, perhaps, that they won't receive it well, or maybe we're reading the situation wrong, or it's this deep-seated competition that we need to root out of the community of Christ. But we need to encourage the gifts given to others. If you see or experience firsthand the grace of God through the faithful actions or contributions of others, please tell them. Encourage them in that gift. It will be like God calling forth that gift again. And having the right person doing the right thing at the right time and place is a real gift to this church. I mean, by way of example, I've been blessed recently. Just last week, a young woman came up to me and said, you know, I now have space in my life, and I really desire to serve the cafe community, and these are the gifts that I have. She had already thought through them and experienced them. How can I lead in the cafe ministry, she asked me. What a blessing it was to meet with her. I want to briefly look through the list that Paul highlights in this passage. I think it would be helpful. Obviously, if you're familiar with Paul's other letters, he only mentions a few gifts here in this passage, seven, in fact. And I think that seven is not a random number. I think it's representative of the totality of the gifts as Paul is recording them here. That seven represents all of the gifts, because we know there are more than seven parts to the body of Christ. But the ones mentioned here are these: prophecy, serving, teaching, exhorting, giving, leading, and showing mercy. Prophecy, the gift of prophecy, is very similar to our modern-day preaching gift. This gift is the Spirit empowering or working within a person to interpret and apply God's word in a given situation to build up the body of Christ. So it's very similar to what preachers do. We know also that preaching is a developed skill, but this specific gift is a gift of grace from God for the benefit of the community of God. And Paul makes the point that one is to prophesy in proportion to the faith, which means, I think, that we are to speak words which are appropriate or in line with the Christian faith and the revelation as given in God's word. And so it adds boundaries to what I'm to say to you this morning. The gift of serving is really meant to be a general ministry word. We get the word deacon from the Greek word used here. And likely Paul is saying if you have the gift of serving, serve. Likely this refers to several serving gifts that are meant to build up the body of Christ. Things like hospitality or music, craftsmanship or intercession or administration. Any serving gift that builds up the body of Christ. Teaching is simply a gift that enables someone to communicate truths, and especially the truths of God's word, so that others can learn. Exhorting or encouraging is the Spirit enabling a person to come along someone in order to bring comfort, counsel, and encouragement so that they feel helped. If someone has the gift of exhortation or encouraging, you would describe them as they are really encouraging. They are someone I want to go talk to and receive their counsel from. But it's also someone who's a truth teller, the person in your life who will tell you, you know what, let someone else do the announcements. They exhort you, tell you the truth, and do so in love. Contributing, also giving in the NIV, while we're all meant to give, the gift of contributing or giving is given to Christians to give their material blessings for the work of the church and the furthering of the gospel with willingness and cheerfulness. So in fact, Paul here exhorts these folks to give generously. The spiritual gift of leading enables a Christian to motivate and direct and inspire God's people to work together to achieve God's purposes in the world. And Paul simply reminds the leaders to do so with zeal or diligence, to continue using your gift of enabling Christians to motivate, direct, and inspire God's people. And then seven, showing mercy. People moved with exceptional empathy and compassion often have the gift of showing mercy. They have empathy and compassion for those who are suffering, and they devote significant time and resources to alleviate it. And Paul wants them to do so cheerfully. This is a burdensome gift. He's lifting their spirits by saying, do so cheerfully. Now, the point of Paul's listing these gifts is really not to explain them or define them all. I think we can work these out within our community. But what he is doing is pointing out the importance of actually doing them. that there are varied gifts within the body of Christ, and each one needs to be done to strengthen and build up the body. If serving, serve. If teaching, teach, he says. If leading, do it with zeal. Do your part is what Paul is really communicating through this list. Do your part. Having gifts that differ according to the grace given to us, he writes, let us use them. The truth is, the church needs you to exercise your gifts. We need you to use your gifts here. Of course, all of us are trained and gifted and encouraged in ways to use our gifts to serve the greater good of the world and our culture. And in God's economy, I believe he uses these also to achieve his purposes in the world, to further his kingdom. But the gifts of the Spirit are given specifically to build up, encourage, and serve one another in the body of Christ, whether it's here or if you're a visitor in your home church. But if you are a member and regular attender at Park Street and you are not using your gift to serve the community here, we suffer. We suffer the loss of whatever it is you would bring. And we miss out on the blessing of your service. Whether you would teach or give or exhort or lead or sing. But I want you to hear me clearly, that God needs you also to exercise your gift in the neighborhood and in your workplace, because exercising your gift is life-giving for you. But if you're giving 110% at the workplace, you have nothing left over for the community here or for your neighborhood. So part of thinking soberly, part of renewing your mind, I think, includes reevaluating your time commitments at work and at school. I have met several brothers and sisters who are giving it their all at work and school and are so overwhelmed that they can't even imagine giving it all at church or in their neighborhood. Now, I'm not looking for volunteers. This isn't a recruiting sermon. That will come in September. I'm just simply saying the Park Street community or your church community suffers when part of the body is not being exercised, not doing its part. And I know it's really difficult to read a list of gifts and try to discern what mine is, but this is maybe the beginning of a journey for you, or maybe you know clearly where it is or what people have told you. You need to be doing this. But I do want to give you just five very quick application points. And once you recognize your gift, or you think you may know what it is, to make a plan to develop and exercise it. The first is to accept some responsibility in the area of your giftedness. Whether it's greeting or singing or praying or teaching, accept some responsibility. Step forward in that area of your giftedness. Two, seek encouragement and feedback from trusted friends and leaders. You know, as you discern your gifts, of course, that's important. But even as you start practicing, I think this feels good. How are you receiving my ministry and my gifts? Three, look for opportunities available to you for using your gifts. And again, this fall, there'll be plenty of opportunities here at church. But look for opportunities elsewhere, too, to use your gift. Four, and this is one that's often overlooked, is take time to learn from those who are more experienced in the area of your gift. If you feel it's teaching, sit in on a class that you know has a solid teacher. Learn from them. For me, this is so helpful as someone that was told, you have the gift of pastoring, you should pastor a church. And I was like, what? Do I know any pastors? And I did. Throughout my 10 years of preparation for ministry, met with some wonderful pastors to see what they did and learn from them. Take the time to learn from those who are more experienced in the area of your gift. And then lastly, five, as you practice and expand the use of your gifts, remember to encourage others in using theirs. Remember to encourage others in using their gifts. I mentioned earlier that Jesus has entrusted the work of the gospel, the unfinished work of the gospel, to us. And we know that he was so concerned about this, and know he, that he was so, it was so important for him that we do our part, that one of his last teachings focused on this very thing. And you're familiar with this teaching, but I'm going to read it again. It's in Matthew chapter 25. If you want to open there, it's fine. You can follow along. It's the parable of the talents. And I'm going to read it again to emphasize both the importance of this to Jesus especially, but also the blessing, the overwhelming blessing that we receive as we practice and do our part in the body of Christ. So Matthew 25, verse 14, Jesus says, "Again, the kingdom of heaven will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted his wealth to them. To one he gave 5 bags of gold, to another 2 bags, and to another 1 bag, each according to his ability. And then he went on his journey. The man who had received 5 bags of gold went at once and put his money to work and gained 5 bags more. So also the one with 2 bags of gold gained 2 more. But the man who had received 1 bag went off, dug a hole in the ground, and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those servants returned and settled accounts with them. The man who had received 5 bags of gold brought the other 5. 'Master,' he said, 'you entrusted me with 5 bags of gold. See, I have gained 5 more.' His master replied, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness.' The man with 2 bags of gold also came. 'Master,' he said, 'you entrusted me with 2 bags of gold. See, I have gained 2 more.' His master replied, 'Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness.'" Now, I want to stop there for a moment and just say that Jesus does a remarkable thing here. He says the exact same thing to the man who had 5 bags of gold and the man who had 2 bags of gold, which is saying that it doesn't matter how many bags of gold you have. It doesn't matter what gift you have. What matters is what you do with it. And then this last man, in verse 24. "Then the man who had received 1 bag of gold came. 'Master,' he said, 'I knew that you had you are a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your gold in the ground. See, here is what belongs to you.' His master replied, 'You wicked, lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well, then you should have put my money on deposit with the banker so that when I returned, I would have received it back with interest, just the minimum. So take the bag of gold from him and give it to the one who has 10 bags. For whoever has will be given more, and they will have an abundance. Whoever does not have, even what they have will be taken from them. And throw that worthless servant outside into the darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. While our master is away, this is what we are to do. According to our ability, according to how we are gifted, we are to use the gifts he has given to us. The grace of salvation, yes, a wonderful gift. The grace of participation with God can lead to a life overflowing with grace and being overwhelmed with Jesus. When I said earlier that we want you to be overwhelmed with Jesus, we also want you to hear these words from our Savior. Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share your master's happiness. That's a good kind of overwhelming. Remember that we have and we need each other. Recognize your God-given gift and do your part to build up the body of Christ. I want to close with just one more phrase from Romans 12:11 from this Children's Living Bible. "Never be lazy in your work, but serve the Lord enthusiastically," it says. Never be lazy in your work, but serve the Lord enthusiastically. Let's do this together as the body of Christ here at Park Street Church, And let's do this out of fully charged life of grace. Amen.